Hello, my beautiful bearded friends. So today we're going to talk about, is there a proven way to grow your beard? I've looked at the science and I'm going to share it with you. If you're new to this channel, please remember to subscribe and hit that bell notification because I'm going to talk about everything I've learned from growing a beard and I am going to share the value with you. Okay, let's take a little look at the proven ways to grow a beard. Now, maybe you're the sort of person that really struggles to grow a beard. And so you've typed into Google, like, how do I grow a beard? The fastest way to grow a beard. And the thing is, when you do that, you end up with a load of snake oil. And by snake oil, I mean products that don't work, that only serve one purpose, and that's to separate you from your money, as opposed to helping you grow a lovely beard. Fortunately, the thing about growing a beard is there are no shortcuts, there are no tricks beyond what I'm going to tell you today. So I'm a PhD qualified scientist and I thought I would look at the research to be like, okay, what is out there, what has happened in the past, and what scientifically based interventions are there for growing a thicker beard. And I'll let you into a little sort of secret now. It's not applying oils. It's not, growth oils. So the first one is probably the most invasive, and it's beard transplants. So beard transplants are a real thing and they have fantastic results. So I found a 2013 study, which I'll link in the description, but also this video is based on an article on beardgrowingpro.com. So I'll put the link in the description and you'll get the link to the articles and the summaries and everything like that. So I found a 2013 study and what they were looking at was the cosmetic implants of hairs on the face. So it was eyebrows, facial hair, beards, goatees, lips, the lot, like every bit of hair on your face. And so they used a process called follicular unit grafting, which FUG is like taking a little bit of hair or taking parts of hair, so not necessarily a strip, but like plucking hairs out from a place where they are unlikely to be removed in the future. Because for me, for example, there would have been no point taking hairs from here because when we planted them here, they would have just fallen out because this part of the hair is affected by the hormones, so that they have androgen receptors. And so I have gone thinning and receding and bald on the top of my head. So the great thing about this is if you take those hairs from a part of the body where the hairs aren't likely to fall out, they will last on your face. And that's because the information about falling out is in the skin around the hair. The hair follicle, and so when you put it, you put a little bit of the skin in as well, so that isn't an issue. So it lasts a long time, and these were the little tricks that they found. So in the study, they recommended that to make it look natural, you needed angulation. So not just like hairs that are just put in randomly, but kind of trying to change the direction of the hair growth or make it look more natural. So angulation is a big thing. And then the biggest issue they found with beard transplants was this area. So from the chin to the lower lip, they found that this area was really hard to transplant. It ended up in bumps and a lot of rejection. So look, this does come with some drawbacks, but beard transplantations, if done properly, is a proven way to actually increase the amount of hair you have on your face. The second way is our favorite, minoxidil. Now, the thing is, this is an off-label use of minoxidil. So normally it's used for balding men. I've never used it, but it's normally used for growing hair on the head. And that's because it was in the 1970s, minoxidil was used for hypertension. Hypertension is a thing like a cardiac or vascular system thing. So it was used for that. And they found that the men were growing beards. And so they're like, I wonder. And that led to a topical treatment. By topical, we mean, you know, a treatment that you put on the outside of your body, like on the skin, and it gets absorbed in. And there's lots of off-label uses, but this seems to be one of the most popular ones. Now, this is not approved by the FDA, right? So it's not approved for use on your face, but there are a few studies. And one of the studies I found was in 2016. And once again, head over to the article on beardgrowingpro.com, and I'll link to the article, and I'll also put it in the description below. And what they did is they used 0.5 milliliters of 3% minoxidil. So you can buy it between, I think, 3 and 5%. They used 3%, and they put it on the skin of a load of men. And then those men, they took photos and sent it in to be reviewed. And what they found is that based on a placebo is just like a gel or a topical treatment that has no effect and no medication whatsoever. They found there was a significant increase in the amount of hair that was grown, which is fantastic. So, you know, the Minoxidil, Minox beards, I think they're called on Reddit, they have known about this for ages, but there's very little evidence and studies and science that have actually been done on the Minoxidil's effect on the beard. So it's fantastic that this 2016 study was performed. Now it's about, okay, what works for you? So head over to Minox Beards on Reddit. That seems to be one of the best places, one of the best resources to go to find out how to grow a beard using Minoxidil. I've never used it, but be careful because there are a load of side effects, and you don't want to continue using it if you suffer from dizziness, rashes, if it's just not working. Like, you need to make sure that you are not sacrificing your health for the sake of growing a beard, but Minoxidil may work for you. The third study that I came across was all about vitamin D. Now, one thing I want to say about this study is that it's not specifically for beards, but rather it is for hair in general. So any hair that grows on your body, there was a study that looked at the role of vitamin D in the hair follicle. And essentially they found that there is a number of vitamin D receptors in the hair follicle, and that increases during the growth phase of the hair. And so the vitamin D acts as an important part of growing body hair, including the beard. And so, yeah, it's a fantastic thing. So vitamin D, including vitamin D in your sort of daily activities, so whether or not that's getting out in the sun, which is the main source of the body getting vitamin D, or going to have a look to see if you're vitamin D deficient. Now, there was a study recently done in 2019 where, because, you know, vitamin D used to be done by a blood test, but they're actually looking at it in the hair, so they can take a hair and have a look to see how much vitamin D you've got in your body over a certain amount of time. But if you're unsure, go to check out if you are vitamin D deficient with your trusted medical health provider. Yeah, it could be that you just need a little bit of a boost. And I think it can come in tablet form, it can come in injection form. But yeah, vitamin D, there is some evidence to say that vitamin D is a very important part of growing a hair. And I would hate for your beard to be suffering, because apparently there is a load of people out there that don't know they have a vitamin D deficiency, and it could be you. Okay, the fourth thing is testosterone. Now, the caveat to this one is that there are some very, very old studies, but it does show the importance of testosterone on growing a beard. So let's have a look. The first one, 1942, was the first evidence where they said, oh, you know, testosterone and DHT, that has an important role in growing a beard. And so what they did is they castrated males before they went through puberty, and they never grew a beard. And also, castration stopped the hair loss of balding men, but it didn't regenerate their hair. And that was the first time. That was, yeah, 1942 was the study where they did that. Going forward a little bit to 1949, what they found in elderly men, they injected them with 25 milligrams of testosterone, and they essentially then shaved them every 24 hours to see how much hair had grown. And they did this over about 2 months. And the issue was, is as men get older, your testosterone decreases by about 1 to 2% every year. So it may be that the testosterone is reducing your body, which has an effect on your beard. But overall, you know, these studies in general show that if you are lacking a little bit of testosterone, then it can really influence your beard growth. And that's because after injecting these elderly males who had suspected like lower testosterone levels, so 25 milligrams of testosterone over 2 months, I think they did it two or three times a week. They weighed the shavings, and the shavings went initially, so 46 milligrams per day was how much shaving came off. They collected it in just like a regular shaver with a collection thing. And I think they put a mat down as well to collect all the shavings. So super good science, not a huge data set, but good methodology. And then after 1 month, that 46 milligrams of beard per day went up to 67 milligrams of beard per day. And after 2 months, it went to 71 milligrams of beard per day. So you can see that having testosterone in your body and injecting it if you are low can actually help. And all of these are medical interventions. So before you do anything, this isn't about DIY. This is about seeking out help from the medical profession if you feel like you're lacking in vitamin D, if you need a beard transplant, or if you want a boost in testosterone in some way. So there we have it. There are the four ways that I found studies to actually support growing a beard hair, and actually sort of like the proven ways to grow a beard. And the thing is they're not pretty, they're not kind of very nice, they're very medically sort of focused. And that's the thing I want to talk about, is the fact that, you know, when you're growing a beard, you really do have to accept the beard you've got. And sure, there are some people that want that kind of extra amount of growth, but you know, these are very invasive things. They can be expensive, they can be dangerous. So you really have to weigh up your options before you think about doing anything else. And there are other ways. So go check out my other video, which is like food groups that you can eat. So go check out that video, because you know, I'm sure that before going to medical interventions that have got proven kind of effects, there are other ways that you can just look after your body and grow a beard that way. So yes, don't jump into these right away, because they are pretty extreme. If you found this video useful, please remember to subscribe and hit that bell notification, because I'd love to share everything I learned with you and all the studying and the experiments that I do on my beard with you. All right, until I see you again, have a lovely day.